Session 3 in the afternoon focuses on the EU policy context, and we would like to relate this to the results of the POLIMP project. The title is Looking Towards Net Zero Emissions in a 1.5 degree world. How ambitious does EU climate change policy need to be post Paris? I recognize that already several topics have been floated in the morning session, so probably we will take stock of it. I will try to connect these dots in my introduction and then pass it to Matthias, my collaborator for the POLIMP project, to kick off the discussion, introducing some updates on the EU policy, climate policy, as well as actual results of the POLIMP project. Then I would invite three stakeholders representing the power sector, research sector, and also NGO sector. Then we will have a floor discussion. Probably we may have a intermission just to collect some questions for clarification in the meantime. So I will have a short introduction, try not to repeat what has been already said, but somehow try to complement what hasn't been said. This may be quite self-explanatory, but I still want to start with where we were after the Paris Agreement. And here, I would like to focus on three components of the long-term ambition, not just 2 degree 1.5, but two other less visible parts of the long-term ambition. So the, as I see it, the main point here is that the EU policy objective, the target, remains well below 2 degrees. But here first, in the, at the international level, we acknowledge the aspirational goal of 1.5 degrees. And this was not something what negotiators had expected before Paris. And then this is followed by another goal to reach a global peaking as soon as possible, then undertake rapid rate action. And for this curve, we should take into account that developing countries started mitigation action much later than developed countries. And these are meant to achieve a balance between between emissions by sources and removables by sinks in the second half of this century. And this can be interpreted as aiming at zero net emissions in the second half of the century. As I see it, if we try to focus on this 1.5 degree as aspirational goal, and also this achieving a balance between emissions and removables, we may need quite different type of technologies from what we have now. And this hasn't been stressed in a policy debate yet. So towards this goal as a package, parties are committed to a 5-year cycle of nationally determined contributions, that is basically national pledges, formulated in a bottom-up way. And these commitments will be followed by a review process agreed in Paris, so-called global stocktake, and an enhanced transparency framework. For the people who missed morning session, the commission official stressed that this is a single transparency framework applicable to both developed countries and developing countries, not separate as they used to be. What does the EU need under this new setting? So we still have this 2030 framework, which was agreed before Paris, and this requires at least 40% emission reductions by 2030. The interesting part is this: the interpretation of at least, because this actually opens different kind of interpretation from different sectors. The second bullet point is equally and even more important after Paris, to invest in transformative technologies that could enable net zero emissions. For example, you could think about bioenergy, CCS, zero emission buildings, electronic vehicles, those things which will be designed from the completely different assumptions. When you look at the different specific targets, then we have to also assess the appropriateness of these current figures, for example, 43% reductions from the ETS sectors, or renewables share at least 20% of the final energy consumption as in the EU as a whole by 2030. Already in the morning discussion, we just touched upon how are we going to allocate renewable energy targets across member states, or if we don't allocate, how are we going to meet this through different methods? So this is just a list of forthcoming proposals which have been also mentioned by the Commission, and the first three legislative proposals are expected in the first half of this year, 2016, and then the last will come between 2016 and 2017. And something missing here is also the importance of transport. Not only urban mobility, but also, for example, aviation that would impact on third countries, or also that would in which EU would also have impact from measures taken by other countries. So we do need international coordination. And from here, I have just three different slides listing up the results of the policy briefs this project has already completed. And not to repeat the same messages from the previous session, I just want to explain briefly what I wanted to address in the context section at the top. So basically, the one challenge was that POLIMP project started 3 years ago. And we produced policy briefs between 2014 and 2015. The final policy brief on the ETS was published 1 year ago. So we are still confident that key findings are valid as output from a scientific project, although focusing on coordination part more. The key findings are valid, but we somehow may need to adapt to the current setting, or at least relate what this means to the current policy debate, because I think that's how we can somehow share our results with stakeholders, and also how we can receive inputs or feedback from stakeholders. So on the EU ETS, the new element would be that there is increased predictability about the regulatory framework at the international level. So now we have a better overview about mitigation adaptation actions to be foreseen between 2020 and 2030, maybe from some countries up to 2025. So that was one big improvement, but on the other hand, this also created uncertainty about implementation, because for the first time, we acknowledged the portfolio of different commitments formulated from bottom-up domestic processes. So we have some ideas about foreseen design options at the country level, but we don't know exactly how these will be implemented and how we can somehow guarantee the expected outcome. For example, I could imagine that some of the multinational companies may have operations in the different regulatory frameworks, and somehow it is now up to them how to follow the guidance from the governments within different jurisdictions. And what this means, at this moment in the EU, there is a much discussion about so-called level playing field. It used to be the problem was lack of carbon constraints, but now we have some sort of carbon constraints everywhere, but we don't know exactly how to compare them. So what this means to business, that's one question I would like to ask to the business stakeholders. Under this context, some of the messages from the POLIMP dialogue with stakeholders would be interesting, and especially the last bullet points coming from the stakeholder dialogue. Just to summarize our approach, we held national or regional stakeholder dialogue for 3 month period in last year, from basically December 2014 to March 2015. And most of the discussion concentrated on the market stability reserve. But there was underlining, and also there was almost dominant concern about the balance between the ETS's potential to incentivize investments on the one hand and the competitiveness concerns on the other. And I think that even though we agreed on the framework, this fundamental concern still remains, and in a different design options. So one of the interesting policy discussion right now is about the innovation funds or modernization funds. On the extension, we also would like to discuss earmarking from the member states' auctioning revenues. And altogether, how would this, for example, help reduce uncertainty about implementation? How this would somehow help us also improve predictability about future? I think that's something interesting for discussion. Financing renewable energy, just to introduce the policy context, there is already some good data from the EEA report from the European Environmental Agency, that basically the EU-wide share of renewable energy has been increasing. Although this performance has a huge variance, for example, Finland had a quite a high figure, like almost 30%, whereas some member states achieved only a little more than 3%. So there is some variance in the performance of the renewable deployment across member states. But one big concern has been the rollback of member state support measures and falling investments. And this means that the investment for renewable energy inside the EU has been stagnating, and that would affect the future achievement, especially in the 2020 to 2030. And this is rather unfortunate when the Paris Agreement gave additional push for the deployment of renewable energies outside the EU. And just for quick data, out of 189 INDCs submitted, 40% of the submissions targeted increased renewables deployment. So this is actually a data I quoted from IEA's World Energy Outlook fact sheets. How can EU improve the prospect for investments in the renewables when other countries are pushing forward, and also the cost of some mature renewable energy technologies itself are falling, so that the cost would be less issue in the future? In that context, we think that the key messages from the POLIMP analysis remain valid, and especially the importance of cost-effective support measures would require strong involvement of stakeholders, because there is a limit for policymakers to design and modify support measures without relying on the subsidies. Second point is also important, which I will address later for summary, that we need to have some mechanisms for risk alleviation and also encourage flow of new sources of financing. And lastly, member states need to coordinate better and also make best use of the cooperation mechanisms already embedded in the directive. The last topic we discussed in the policy brief series was public acceptance, which has been already discussed in the morning to some extent. we found from empirical evidence that the majority of the public support majority of the public supports renewable energy in general, but oppose individual projects. So the resistance are quite serious at some projects, and this is unfortunate when we think about the outcome of the or impact of the Paris Agreement. We are ready to somehow assess future technology options which would enable zero net emissions, for example, but if public are not ready to accept the implementation at the project level, then this would be a barrier to policy implementation. So the technology uptake is not just depending on the policy choice, but also depending on the public attitude or perception. So we identified 5 or 6 these different criteria for improving the public acceptance. And further detail has been reported in the policy brief. I would highlight that especially important is the trust in decision makers and stakeholders, and also overall evaluation of cost risks and benefits, because this has some common elements with our discussion on the renewable energies, naturally. Just to summarize, in the so-called synthesis paper, we made some copies at the entrance area. We identified 3 different challenges. The summarizing the essence of the policy brief series. So we think it is important to enhance incentives for private investments across support measures and the instruments. Also to address how to manage and reduce economic and social risks, in particular those of financing both mature and less developed technologies, and to increase the cost effectiveness of the renewable energy financing and support measures. And to address these 3 different challenges, probably we need to put more efforts in improving an integrated approach to low carbon technology support and also low carbon pricing support. And one remaining question is policy interaction, because, for example, the current ETS performance has been naturally affected by other parallel measures, renewable energy directive and also energy efficiency directives. This is not something we can conclude in the POLIMP project, but for example, in the Charisma project, to succeed this one, we are going to also address policy interaction and the effect of this interaction on the mitigation action. So I would like to now close my introduction and then pass it to Matthias.